Hi, I'm David Bigley, and I'd like to welcome you to another episode of Cohasset Open Studios. Today we have three very different artists are going to welcome us into their studios, explain their work a little bit, show us a little bit of how they create their art. The first one is Stephen Sheffield, a photographer. The second one is Gwyned Trefethen, and she will be doing some fabric work. And the third one is Margot Cheel, and she'll talk about her aerial photography. So why don't we get going, and we'll go down to the studio of Stephen Sheffield down on South Main Street.
I'm Steve Sheffield. I am a local Cohasset artist, and welcome to my carriage house gallery studio. I do a lot of large work out here, but I also have a dark room and another studio in my home across the way right there. Well, first of all, welcome, and all this work is up for this year's Cohasset Open Studios, and we had a lot more traffic than I thought we were going to have, and it was a beautiful weekend for it, so it was really exceptional. A little bit of history about me. I am a mid-career artist. I went to Cornell University in 1984, where I got my bachelor's degree in photography and mixed media. And then a few years later, I got a master's degree at the California College of the Arts out in Oakland and San Francisco. And from that point on, I've been making art, showing in galleries locally, nationally, and teaching on the graduate level as well as the college level in photography and fine art. After graduate school, I moved to Boston and got a loft studio in the Seaport District, Fort Point Channel, where I had a large studio there for about 20 years, working, making art. So most of the work that you see here, in fact all of the work that you see here is film photography, shot with a large format camera, and I develop all that work in my darkroom here across the way. So this is one of my cameras that I use. It's a large format camera, sort of where the film would go in the back, very large pieces of film. This particular camera stays here in the studio, and I have a couple of others that I bring out in the field with me to do some of this work that is more out in the environment. So I wanted to focus on one particular piece that I made recently. And this is a large piece, and the title of it is called The I and the Not I, which the title of it comes from a book that I read, which is literally about sort of reaching in within yourself to find who you are that is not on the surface. And that led towards me starting to really think about the masks that we wear. So this is quite a literal interpretation of that, but I think it makes a pretty provocative image. Some years ago, I don't know, maybe 5 years ago, I made this piece, which doesn't have a really specific meaning other than I thought it was a provocative way of shooting and also thinking about the actual object of this sort of life ring. And it's been a pretty interesting piece and a popular piece with people. And my son at the time watched me take the picture. And a few years ago, he decided that he wanted to be in some of my pictures as well. And we decided we'd try to sort of copy a few of them. And so that's where this came from. And just about a year or so ago, we decided we would try to repeat this photograph together. And we had such a great time of it. And it's also, I think, become a pretty poignant photograph and a great document for me. These are called cyanotypes, and what this means is that this is a painted-on emulsion, and the image itself needs to be the size of the negative that's placed on it. And so you paint on this light-sensitive emulsion and then expose it to the sun, and the image prints on the paper. So I love the brush strokes around the outside, And I love that you exposure is made with sunlight. It takes about 15 minutes. And the developer is water. So it's one of the safer, more environmentally friendly photographic processes out. One of the things that I like about it is that you can literally use virtually any surface that has a tooth to it. An example of that is just ledger paper that I have found junk stores or whatever because I like the texture to it. These in this frame are just Xeroxes that I've done the process to, and I've even used the backside of my wedding invitation, which was on really nice paper, so the prints ended up looking really good. But it's funny to have something from, oh my gosh, 18 years ago, get a new life with fresh art.
I get a lot of comments about my beautiful chandelier here in my studio. Believe it or not, it is arms, mannequin arms. And yes, I collect that kind of thing. And this is in fact about 20 years old from when I had a studio in Boston and it was hanging over my meeting table that I would meet clients at and art collectors and whatnot, and that would be a really good distraction for them. So it now lives here in my outdoor studio. So thank you so much for having a look around my studio, and what I'd like to say is you can visit me here by appointment. You can have a look at my work online at stephensheffield.com. I teach classes at the South Shore Arts Center, and you can look me up. I teach a collage class, and I teach photography classes, and I also teach one-on-one with people and do art mentoring. So I've got a number of people that I meet with once a week or once a month, and we literally just work out what they're doing in their work and move them forward.
That was terrific. It was really interesting to see the large format camera and to see a photographer still actually using film. So next we're going to go again down South Main Street, and we're going to go into the home studio of Gwyned Trefethen. She works with fabric and making quilts, so we'll head down to her studio now.
Hello, I'm so glad you can visit with me today. My name is Gwyned Trefethen, and I create my art using fiber and thread. If that means nothing to you, I hope taking this visit in my home, which doubles as a gallery and studio space, will be helpful. So come on in. My studio is upstairs, so come on up with me and we'll take a tour. You caught me at a great time. I'm in the middle of a work in progress, which I usually am, so I thought I'd show you the various things I do from idea to fruition. Frequently, when I design a work, I begin with a photograph. Often the photograph is taken by my husband during one of our pre-dawn to dawn walks. And this particular one, I'm not sure which beach it is, but it is definitely a beach in Cohasset at sunrise. Using a computer application called Electric Quilt 8, I design a blueprint or framework on how I'm going to piece the work itself. I never choose the colors directly in the computer program, although I could, because I prefer to work intuitively based on the drawing as I'm going on. So this is a very simple block design, everything on the diagonal, and I simply marked on the template itself where the two black pieces are in the individual block so I can keep track of that. Literally stitched directly on the paper itself. There you can see the template on the back, And because I use very tiny, tiny stitches that I can create on the sewing machine, when it comes time, I can peel off the paper. If I use bigger stitches, the paper would get stuck. When I start to build the quilt itself, one of the crucial things to decide is the palette. I may reference the photograph for the palette, but I don't choose fabric that matches the photograph exactly. I use design principles, and in this particular case, I chose a jewel-toned palette to go with the sunrise. All the fabric that you see here is a mix of fabrics that I have either hand-dyed myself, painted, done other surface design technique, or there are a few commercial fabrics mixed in. Unlike the domestic machine I just showed you, the Bernina, this is a professional quilting machine from American Professional Quilting Systems, and it is literally called the George. All it does is have the needle go up and down. Seems like an awfully large machine to only do one stitch, and it doesn't even move the fabric. You have a machine like this in order to do something called free motion quilting. So this piece is called Sunrise Over the Gulf River. So if you're from the South Shore, Cohasset area watching this, that would be a familiar place for you. It's just off of Gannett Road, I believe. It's a road and not a street. Now you can see what happens when you have all three layers together. There's a back to this, as well as a front, and in the middle is something called batting. Batting was traditionally used in a quilt in order to keep it warm when you're on a bed, but now it's used to give dimensionality or a bas relief look when you do quilting. And if you come in close, you can see the free motion quilting that I've added as an additional design element to this piece. Up above is the sky with some clouds in it. And so when I was designing the free motion quilting, I wanted to give a sense of a little bit of wind. So down here in the water section, I used a different design element as I was free motion quilting to create a sense of ripple and movement in the water. It's important to have a variety of threads. These aren't used so much for seaming as these are the threads that I use in the quilting work. I store my fabric in different sections, and this is my collection of all the fabrics that I've created myself. Each one begins as a solid white piece, and I either paint them, dye them, stamp them to create the colors and patterns on the fabric that I want. This one is a piece that is not based on a photograph. I did design it in Electric Quilt 8 just to get the various lines that I wanted to create. It is an abstraction, but it reminds me of a turbulent sea and a night sky. Okay. I'm so glad you could visit with me today, and I hope you'll get in touch. I'm easy to reach, either through email or my website. All you have to do is remember my name, Gwyned, and if you can spell it, you can find me.
Thank you so much, Gwyned. Beautiful, beautiful work. It's really interesting, that process of going from a photograph and how she lays it all out and creates these stunning fabric works. So next, we're headed to the studio, and actually up in the air, with Margot Cheel, a local Cohasset resident. She's an aerial photographer, and she does some beautiful interpretive work of the seashores up and down the South Shore. So let's check in with Margot.
Welcome to Plymouth, Massachusetts Airport. This is my home base, where I fly and make photos from the air. And because both flying and photography are arts, and both of them take a lot of concentration, whenever I go up to fly and take photos, I have a co-pilot with me. So come along on a flight to see what I see.
When I took my first introductory flight and saw the Earth below, the view was exhilarating and I was hooked. Soon after earning my pilot's license, I brought the passion for this flying to my love of the arts, and I began a career in aerial photography. I found the view from above so unusual, and it offered opportunities for photographing scenes of beauty or fragility or change or connection. It's interesting to see from the aerial view how rivers meander and where they go. The breaks along the Cape Cod National Seashore in recent years can be seen from a wide perspective from above. The shallow waters offer this aqua color, and low tide in Cape Cod Bay shows these sand ripples, not something you see on the beach or on the land. With the perspective from above, you can see patterns that you don't see when you're on the land or the shore, and also make discoveries. Here is a sunken ship that is only seen from above at low tide in the Duxbury Bay. One of the reasons for my doing this aerial photography is to inspire awareness of our environment, to see the connections and changes and beauty. And if this is a place you love, don't you want to take steps to preserve it? When I first started aerial photography, I was generally doing places that I was familiar with, my neighborhood, for example. And what surprised me, which was unexpected, was that the view from above was absolutely beautiful. This is an example of it. This is Cohasset Common, I shot this in November when the light was low at 3 o'clock in the afternoon and that golden glow comes across those trees. So this is the kind of representational kind of photography from the air that I started with. I still do too. Over here, this is Minot Light, a very popular icon that people like photos of. So it too is a representational. When I was flying, I discovered that down below, there was this beautiful patterns that was made with the land and the sea and the sand. And I then started doing photographs of that because I found it really fascinating. This is an example of one. This is the spit where the North River winds around and empties into the Atlantic Ocean. With the more abstract qualities that are in the landscape, I discovered this particular scene, which is in Cape Cod Bay. I went and I had each of them printed individually. This is one actual image, and I had it divided into three parts, and they were each printed on panels, and when they're lined up on a wall, they became a triptych. These are two images which are printed on canvas that are really quite abstract. It's the color and the depth and the water. And the thing is that these are actual places. I didn't make these up. I didn't paint them from my mind. These are actually places of sand and water that are actually off Cape Cod. This image is of Cape Cod National Seashore, where there have been a number of breaks over the last recent years. It's something that for fishermen and for the economy and for boaters, it's not particularly a favored thing. But when you look at it from above, one, you see what's happened, and two, aesthetically, it is very, very striking. This image and the moonrise image are both printed in the dye sublimation process, which is on aluminum. It gives color, which really, really stands out. I decided after I had quite a collection of images that I would produce an aerial photography book that is of the images of beautiful coastline of southern Massachusetts and of Cape Cod. And in it, I also include quotes from aviators, their impression and their thrill and excitement of what they see from the air, which has been my experience as well. After this first book, I decided to do another book, and it came about because often at many of my exhibits, there would be children who would come up and start looking at the images, and they would find things that their parents didn't see and others didn't. So I got the idea all these forms that I do see from the air would be fun to put into a book, and it could be for kids of all ages, from 4 to 94. So that's how this book came out, and the title really says it, What Do You See Finding Shapes from the Sky? Thank you for joining with me today, where I've shown you my love of flying that's joined my love of photographing. So just like this sailboat, it's a journey, and I will continue to be journeying with new places, new sights, and new adventures. Join me on my website, which is margotcheel.com. Thank you, and blue skies and tailwinds to you.
Terrific, Margot, thank you. I love the picture of the pumpkin patch that she put in there. She has photographed the pattern of the ASP pumpkin patch every year. And she's an avid, longtime supporter of ASP. So there we are. There you have it. Three thriving artists right here among us here in Cohasset, and we hope you enjoyed today's show. And we look forward to another presentation coming up soon. So thank you so much for watching, and don't forget. Buy what you love.